pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everybody. We have our first item tonight. We have state and town project updates. Pam?
Nothing new tonight.
Okay,
Mr.
great.
President.
Thank you. So we'll move on to our open forum, public comment section of the meeting. Issues of concern in the town, if you could limit your remarks to 3 minutes. Anybody? Stan?
Reading the paper the other day. I want to thank Councilman Rinaldi for bringing up ideas about surpluses. Last meeting, I guess we got into school surplus, town surplus, and I guess I didn't think about it too much, but we had at one time we had a $5+ million surplus in the school, and we went out and got a bond for $3.4 million for this field. We had the money, but we go out and borrow it. Same thing for the town. We have a $7 million surplus. We go out and borrow $1 million for the police station. You know, in the old days, I guess we had to have surpluses, I guess they say, for the financial conditions. So when you need to build a school, or we need to build a fire station, or we need to build something, we need the money there to get bonds. But we are built out in this town. I said again, I want to just repeat it again. I think we're built out in this town. I think the town planner said something like 85% built out. I don't think we're going to have a lot of building going on. I don't think we're going to need to build any schools. I don't think we're going to build any fire stations or police stations. So I don't see a need for building and bonds significant for the next few years. We have the baby boomer generation here. They're not making any kids. Now, unless the Spanish families or the Middle Eastern families move in with their children, I don't think we've got a problem here. I look at my own daughter. She, 2 kids, that's it. I don't have no more kids. I got 2 brothers. After they saw me with 5 kids, no kids. So the current generation, I think, is not really big on having kids. So I don't think we're going to be really, population is going to really significantly change. So our status is going to change. Therefore, we no longer need these surpluses to justify bonds or whatever. We don't need the bonds. Pay as you go. If we can't afford it, don't buy it. So we need to change our mindset. This is a new time. School population, for the last 2 decades, is it? Going down. I don't see it. I don't see it come back. The whole state's going down by the looks of it. So we've got to change our mindset to pay our bills and don't count on taking out mortgages anymore. That's what I call the bonds and mortgages. And I want to thank you, Councilman, for making that first step into looking at this surplus necessity. Not only should the school be together with the town, but I'm not so sure what kind of surplus we should have at all. We should be paying our bills as we need to and not think about, oh, we got all the surplus money. Let's use it up. Thank you.
Thank you. Richard.
I just came from the Finance Committee, and there I thanked Laura, Pam, and Kathy for making progress on other post-employment benefits. You know, 7 years ago, was 6 or 7 years ago, was $70 million with no assets. Now it's $58 million with $2.5 million of assets. When you consider there's a natural growth of $2 million a year, a substantial decrease is much more significant. The problem is the future, and I offered to the committee, I offered to you two relatively easy, if anything is easy in this game, solutions that hopefully we could agree with, and that is to limit COLAs to $300 or $400, meaning the lower paid, lower earning retirees would still get their 3%, but at it would cap off at $400, for instance, giving those who earn more, they still get something, a lot more than we get in Social Security. That type of adjustment would make a world of difference, because I will point out again, the true loser in financial inflexibility or on the way to bankruptcy are the retirees, but more significantly, the current employees in Rhode Island. They take the hit, not the bondholder. And the bondholder in Rhode Island, municipal bondholder, very well protected. You saw that in Central Falls. I say to you, it is possible with an all-out effort and discussion with retirees as well as current employees that we could come out with something reasonable. The other solution is to fess up and pay the penalty on those retirees for whom we are currently paying everything in medical costs and put them on Medicare. Or this KTP program, which I think deserves a closer hearing. We could really do a tremendous thing if we focus on this. But I do want to congratulate the people involved for the last 4 or 5 years, 6 years. At least we know the problem. We have made some steps to solve it. We haven't done enough, but we certainly are a lot better off than we would have been if we did nothing 6 or 7 years ago.
Thank you, Richard. Is there anyone else?
Mr. President, can I make a motion to move up under new business, motion 15 to the front of the agenda?
You want to do that after the consent agenda?
Yeah, that would be fine.
Is there a second for that?
Second.
Discussion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed, so we're moving item number 15 to after the consent agenda, Anne. All right, so looking at the consent agenda, are there any items that any council members would like to remove from the consent agenda? All right, hearing none. All in favor of approving the consent agenda?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed, motion approved 5-0. Item number 15, a motion to it's not item 15. Is that the item?
Yes.
Okay, a motion to receive and accept a grant from the Narragansett Youth Task Force?
Yes.
Is that it? Okay.
Yes.
A motion to receive and accept a grant from the Narragansett Youth Task Force through the Rhode Island Department of Transportation Office on Highway Safety for the Highway Safety Program grant in the amount of $10,662 and approve the purchase of ID checking systems from Advanced ID Detection LLC for the full amount.
I'll move the motion.
Second.
Discussion item, I believe, comes from the police chief and from Nancy. Is that correct?
I think Nancy.
Do you want to come forward?
Nancy wanted to make some clarifications. Nancy wanted to make some clarifications.
And I invited them both forward, yeah. Does anyone have going to present it?
I'm just going to tell you a little bit about
the
grant. First of all, we haven't been the Narragansett Youth Task Force in about 8 years. It's the Narragansett Prevention Partnership. So I want to first correct that. And you may have gotten in your full packet the full amount for the grant, which is $32,000. And it's a designated driver grant with the students at URI, and working with two local establishments, the Bonview and Charlie O's. And on designated weekends, the students will be able to meet with the person that we're hiring, that will be a student at URI, and go to them and receive information about what a designated driver is. It's not the least drunk person in the party. It's the person who's not consuming alcohol for the evening. And they will get a little wristband that looks like this. The name of the program is Friends Matter. And that person will be able to go to the bar on that particular night. There's four different weekends at Charlie O's, and it's pretty much every other Thursday night at the Bon View. And that person will be able to bring their friends, which they'll have to list who those friends are, and be able to go to the bar, and they will be able to have soft drinks all evening on the house. And at the end of the evening, they will receive, at Charlie O's, they'll be getting a $20 gift certificate, and from the Bon View, they'll get a $25 gift certificate to come back at a later date, both of which are restaurant bars, so they could, in fact, come back and consume food. The whole program is going to be marketed through social media, which is why I'm not doing it, since I'm old and I barely can get on Facebook. But the students at URI, they'll be promoting it on all the different social media platforms and really not only promoting this program, but promoting the concept of being a good neighbor and in, you know, the students that live here in Narragansett. We're hoping that that message comes across. We'll be working with a marketing agency that's going to be doing some of the advertising for us, and you know, some of the catchphrases that the kids will be using on the social media. But it's really a win-win. And for the bars just aren't giving out these gift certificates for nothing. Their get for part of the grant is a state-of-the-art ID checker for the length of time that the grant will go, and that's through September 29th. And the police department actually will own both of the ID checkers. They currently have one, a mobile unit, and this will be a unit that Charlie O's and the Bon View will be able to use seven nights a week if they choose during the extent of the grant. But it will really help them in hoping to prevent underage drinking at all times. And both the bars have really been great to work with. In fact, Mike Aiello from the Bon View suggested a great piece of this, which will be, if you're going to the Bon View, not only will you get your $25 gift certificate at the end of the night, but when you show up with this form that says your name and the four or five or six kids that you're bringing, you get to go to the front of the line at the Bon View. And so rather than stand in line for 150, 200 kids, they get to go to the front of the line. But working with the police department, they will be doing DUI patrols on all the weekends, like as they normally do, but we're going to be tracking that to see whether the program, in fact, makes a difference in DUIs, whether we see a decreased amount of driving while impaired. They've been great partners, and the reason why this is before you is the grant, of course, is on a reimbursement basis, and the Narragansett Prevention Partnership didn't have the $10,662 to put up for the ID checkers, so the police department is running that through them, and when we get reimbursed from the grant, that money will be reimbursed to the police department.
So, Nancy, can I just ask, is this creative program, are you copying some other city or town, or did you create this with the department?
Well,
is this an original idea?
A colleague of mine that owns the Coliseum in Providence was doing a similar program that they did, and kids would go to the Coliseum, and they'd have to contact him directly. And so I just expanded on that to try to make it really fit for Narragansett and URI population. So it was a grant through the Department of Transportation and the highway safety portion of DOT.
And you'll let us know how effective it is.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. We're hoping to get some media out of it. I really hope that, you know, we're going to be doing some certainly some ads in the Cigar on campus, as well as some, you know, some other promotions in the local newspapers, because these bars are, you know, they're, if you have 10 kids a night and they're each getting $20, $25, you know, that's a big chunk of change coming out of these restaurants. And it's very cooperative, them, responsible. They're both really on board and are hoping to reduce our DUIs. So that's why they're doing it.
Great.
So, Nancy, you have two bars doing it now?
Two bars, yeah.
And did you go out and solicit those particular bars?
We could only afford in the grant the two ID checkers, so that's the incentive for them to work with us. And you know, was really recommended. We had the Bond View from the get go. They were on board, and they actually helped create some of the program. Yeah. And you know, with the police chief's suggestion, we really pursued Charlie O's a little stronger. I wasn't, you know, I didn't have him on board originally, but we got him on board, so.
Well, congratulations. This is really nice.
Yeah.
Thanks for the work that you did.
We'll be doing that, so.
Questions for me?
Thank you both.
Thanks. Thank you.
Might I formally amend the motion to change Narragansett Youth Task Force to Narragansett Prevention Partnership?
And I'll second that.
Right. Motion from Susan, second from Ray. That's on, just on the amendment. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? And then a motion on the full item, on item number 15.
I'll move the all motion.
Thank you. Second. Steve, would you like to speak to it? Come on up.
Thank you, council members. I just had a question about it. I know I heard the way it was spoken. Correct me if I'm wrong. So, in other words, someone is able to, is a designated driver, and they have a wristband, and they are able to drive other people to the restaurant or whatever the bar, and the designated driver cannot drink. Can the patrons with them drink? Okay,
yeah,
so they
the
can
driver,
drink.
They can't, but the other
right, okay. And then they, and then as a hook or whatever, they get to go to the front of the line.
As a what?
To drink, for this.
No. When the Bond View has functions where they have entertainment,
right.
There's a line wraps around the building sometime, and from what Nancy just told us, the Bond View has offered to allow that person with the wristband and his group to go to the front of the line to get in.
Oh, to get in, okay.
Just to get in the door to be entertained. Now, whether they drink or not and how much they drink is not part of the program.
No, I understand.
But the designated driver is.
Okay, all right. So basically we're incentivizing a designated driver to, you know, to carry other people to the... Okay, I understand that. I just had some issue with, you know, I just... hope we should be able to get designated drivers to do it on their own. That's really would be the ultimate goal. But I mean, you know, I don't want to split hairs about it. But as long as they're not, I just, when I heard to the front of the line, I says, okay, now they're all going to get in the front of the line, belly up to the bar or whatever. So,
they're reinforcing the drivers.
No, that's the older people. Right. Right.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions?
So I move the motion.
Second.
All right. Second from Ray. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nancy.
Old business. Item number 12 is a motion to direct the town manager to prepare and advertise a request for proposals for a phase 2 environmental site assessment for 45 Avis Street.
I'll move the motion.
Second.
Discussion. The item comes from Ray and Patrick.
Okay, this Avis Street facility is the old, repaired the buses. Buses have now moved over to Westmoreland. I think it's time maybe to get that property prepared for and put it on the market and get some nice homes in there so we can collect some revenue. And that's basically it. So I'm looking to direct the town to do an assessment, an environmental assessment, and get that property ready to go.
So I just have a couple of questions. So Avis Street is where we store all of our equipment, correct?
Yes.
So if we sell that and we don't have an opportunity to find a parcel, which we had talked about at the last meeting, over by where it actually is on Westmoreland, then what are we going to do with all the park and rec and the DPW things that are in there? So I kind of was thinking maybe we should see if there's an opportunity near Westmoreland to purchase something before we sell a place that we use for our storage, because I know Park and Rec uses it, DPW uses it, it's in the, you know, sort of centrally located. So I worry about selling off that land before we have an opportunity to think about what we're going to do with all the things in those bays. So I'm not opposed to it, but I'm thinking we should do it the other way first. See if there's an opportunity on Westmoreland. I know there are some people that have some lots down there. Maybe they will sell a lot. We could purchase that for the overflow of storage equipment, and then sell that. But I worry about...
Yeah, that's a good point, Sue. And what I've done is I've reached out to the person who has the property next to the DPW, and we have a meeting tomorrow with the town manager, and we're going to discuss exactly what you're saying, and see if there's some opportunity there to possibly do a land trade. We have Dawson coming in on that meeting, and Chris and Pam, myself, and Laura, just to talk about exactly what you just said, exactly. Right. And I, you know, I appreciate the support on that. That is a great idea.
Right. So before we do a big study on this land, I think that meeting that you have planned for tomorrow probably would be clearer for me to say, okay, yeah, there's a parcel. Somebody wants to sell it. We want to buy it. Okay, then let's sell off the property that the town owns. I just think it's backwards.
Well, I'm going to agree with you a little bit on that too. In that, I'd like to enable the town manager to be able to look for grants, possibly, to do this study, and at the same time, at some point in our budget process, put the money towards it.
Right.
Instead, and if I have to put an addendum to this to say that, then I don't have a problem with that. So, so there's two ways to look at it. One is to go out there and find grant money to do the study, and the second way would be to put it in our budget in the future, but at least allow the town manager, through this motion, to start the process.
Right.
Yeah, we may be able to work it into the deal.
But then we don't need the motion. What we would do in April is, Pam, which department would this come under? Would this be under engineering?
I have a very real and immediate concern. We didn't budget for this environmental site assessment. I've been talking to staff, the price is going to be between $15,000 and $25,000. We don't have it budgeted. The last time this came up, we decided to wait until the new budget. So I don't know where the money would come from to do this.
Right.
It preempts all the other, because I don't know where we'd get the money to do the study. Okay, it's
so
not cheap.
So you understand what I meant about looking for some type of grant or... I don't know that there's anything out there either, but ask you to do that, then
no,
where are we?
I've written grants my entire career, and I've never seen anything out there that would give us money for a phase two environmental site assessment. Not that I won't look, because I will.
So
I will
if
we
have
that.
To amend it to get grant money, why don't you have the meeting tomorrow, and then in the budget season, like you had recommended, why don't we just do it then? I mean, is it that immediate that we have to vote to direct the manager to...
Well, we should put the money aside in the budget or not. That's what we should, and it should come in the budget process
won't take effect till July 1st.
Right.
The new budget takes effect July 1st.
Right.
That's what we're talking about here.
Right. Okay.
Well, the thing is, we it's taken two meetings just to have a discussion about it, okay? All right? I mean, you know, by the time, you know, why don't we make it contingent upon finding the money in the budget by July 1st. Put a deadline on it.
I think this is one of the problems with some of these motions, though, that come up. We have motions that aren't ready, and the budget process is where you have the discussion.
I'm going to find at least $25,000 in the budget this year. I can think of at least one thing that we can kill.
And why do we, which is fine. I mean, I have several other questions about this, but I think what we would want to do is, if you're going to look at land swap or grant money, my view would be is that we would wait till the budget process. I mean, we this is common all the 3 years that I've gone through the budget process, is you wait and see if you have an idea that's going to be, you know, it's not a $500 item. You know, it's not like we can just grab 500 from, you know,
on the,
that
on
wasn't
the other
spent.
Hand, the property, if the property's going to stay the way it is and we don't do anything, right, then we're sitting on a piece of property that might be dirty, might not be dirty, and it's next to homes. It's I think it's wrong to leave it that way myself. If I were in a butter,
so you
I'd be complaining.
But they're not complaining.
That's right, fine. Maybe they will after this, but if I were a butter,
I don't know why we're trying to create a crisis.
Yeah. Well, because,
it's the right thing to do.
Well, my reason
it's not.
My reasoning is we have redundant property. This property sticks out. It's in a residential area. It's a commercial property, used for years. It needs to be grubbed out, cut up, and put single-family homes on it. That's the single best use. It's in the comp plan. I'm pretty sure we can expand down there somewhere on Westmoreland to accommodate whatever's going on there now. All right. I just want to move this forward. Well, just so we don't have this conversation a year from now, and I might not even be here a year from now.
So again, you have a meeting tomorrow. It just seems like this an amendment and an amendment. Have the meeting tomorrow. See if there's a parcel of land, and then come back at the budget season. I don't. It doesn't make sense to me right this minute.
Thoughts?
You have a lot of thoughts. Yes, just a phase two RFP. We're just trying to get bid it out and see what it would cost. Points, it's well taken on both sides. We want to see what's actually going on that property. Should we decide to sell it? Should we decide to sell it? We don't know. We're not going that far yet. This is just an RFP. Nothing. We don't have the money right now. It's not like we can find $500. It's possibly $20,000. In these upcoming discussions with the potential, you know, for potentially purchasing another piece of property, this may even be covered in negotiations, right, within the next month or so. We don't know, and we don't want to negotiate in public here, but it's a real fluid situation. I would just suggest we put this off for just a little bit. You know, on the record, I'm in favor of going ahead with this thing. But the practical part of me says we just don't have 20 grand floating around, and I don't know where, if we can't find $5,000 for a dinner for the people and the boards and commissions, I don't know how we're going to find $20,000 for a phase two. I mean, I like what you're doing. I'm in favor of it. Let's just see how things are going for the next couple of weeks, and we can put it on next week if things are looking if it's looking positive over the next week or so, we can do it again.
Sure.
Do you guys want to continue it?
Who seconded? We can either withdraw
or
continue.
All right. I'm going to make a motion to continue this.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Item number 13 is a motion to approve the change order for the reconstruction of Houston Avenue as part of the road improvement project with Carty Corporation in the amount of $212,049. And 51 cents.
I'll move the motion.
Second.
Discussion. This item comes from Mike, so I was going to have Mike, do you want to explain? My understanding of it is that as part of the road bond, there's on this particular road, there's huge boulders that need to be blasted through, and it's an increase in the anticipated cost of fixing that particular road. But is that correct, Mike?
Right. And okay, it's probably a mistake on my part. It probably should have been a ratify and confirm. The project is complete. It was a decision we had to make on the fly because the road was already pulverized and boulders everywhere.
Yep.
And so we had to make that decision to excavate the road and put down grid fabric, new process gravel, because took soil samples prior to and they were clean, but when we got into the road, it wasn't there, so
right,
we had to make that decision.
So, Mike, what does this? Obviously, I can understand what it does to the budget. What are we going to lose from? We have a certain amount of money designated. I'm right. Sure somebody went out there and did a study of what we're going to be able to do and not do if we didn't have enough money. Did we have a contingency? What was that contingency? And you don't have to answer.
It was within what was budgeted within the bond range for this project for the phase 1B. So there was money there.
Okay, so there was a contingency, and this 212 comes from the contingency?
No.
Maybe Laura could explain it to us.
This is coming out of the general bond.
Yeah, it was in the general bond. So the phase two amount was there. So where we saved on some and others, the money was there to complete this.
So a phase, if I can understand, if people could understand.
Phase 1B.
So a later phase, there's phase, like one of maybe the later roads, we might not have in the full 17 million. Maybe we'd have to use operational funds instead of bond money to fix one of the late roads in maybe phase three.
If need be. But, in the end, the decision that was made, we would have had a road that might have lasted 3 to 5 years, where we have a road that's going to last up to 30 years now. So.
Yeah. Now, with regard to this, I think you made the right decision. But I was just asking if this came out of contingency money or if it wasn't.
It was the bond money that was allocated for the 1B project, so it's the money that's there for the 1B project.
And you say you are saving in some areas?
Yep.
Great. Nice to see you, Mike. Thanks.
So I'm going to look for an amendment for this to be a motion to approve, ratify, and confirm.
Yeah, so moved.
I can put it on the next one.
Second.
No, we'll do it tonight.
Oh, okay.
Second, so this is just on the amendment.
I had a question, Mike.
Go ahead.
How much of that cost was due to DEM and that elaborate drainage system he had to put in?
The drainage system?
And if so, is there any way we can get money out of them, out of DEM or them? Either way you want to call them, but the state, the kind of grant money or drain money there for them.
Unfortunately, the drainage system didn't have anything to do with the road base itself. The design and the construction of the drainage system, was a hefty cost in the road design.
Now, is there any way we get the state to spring for that? No.
We try.
Is there a bond grant, Pam? Is there anything we can do to get the state to pay for that drainage system on Houston to offset these costs? Because I've been down there. I mean, it's like Disney World there.
The new drainage that's going into Metatuxet is all grant money paying for that drainage.
Right.
With the same built into the bond project.
Okay.
So all the drainage that you'll see going into Metatuxet is all grant money that's going to be paying for
that. So we'll be offsetting these costs somewhere.
Yes.
In another road. Yes. All right. Good enough.
So there is DEM money paying for some of the drainage.
Because that's quite an elaborate.
Yeah, it is.
That's where all the woven came from, right?
All the what?
The woven, 30, what is it?
30 grand.
30 grand for woven.
No,
Yeah. Mike, thank you for all your work on this bond. I know it's been a challenge.
Thanks. Thank you.
All right, this is just on the amendment. All in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 5-0. And now on the full motion, the fully amended motion, item number 13. Is there a motion?
I'll move the motion.
Second.
Second by Ray. yes. Are you glad I looked up? Mr. Gardner.
I'm going to urge you people to postpone this, and here's why. If you look at the size of the project, so that's approximately 2,500 feet long. In the project papers, it says it's 23 feet wide. I looked at it and bumped up the numbers to 2,600 feet long, 30 feet wide, comes out to 78,000 square feet. If you run those numbers using the bid numbers from CADI, the numbers on the proposal are off exclusive of the excavation. They're off by about $100,000. So,
you're talking about the change order finger?
The change order. On the bid, they bid $1 a ton for gravel. That would require about 1,900 cubic yards. There's a ton and a half in a cubic yard. So that comes out to about $22,000, and on their proposal they have $77,000. If you look at their proposal for grid, it's similar. They bid $450 a yard, that comes out to about $39,000. If you look at the nonwoven fabric, they bid $2 a yard. So if you do the math on this, and the thing about the gravel in the bids, it was the most specific of all the bids in that package that's referred to you on the miscellaneous road construction. As a matter of fact, there was even an addendum spelling out the change from cubic yards to tons, and that the application of the gravel was supposed to be included in the cost. So, are we proofing our numbers? When we get a proposal from our contractor on a change order, do we run the numbers against the math? So when I did it, you know, what it said, 8 inches of gravel times the square foot.
I'm following the numbers, and as soon as you're done, I'm going to ask Mike to come back.
140 million pounds of gravel.
We get double charged for it.
So will we want to approach Cardi?
What I'd like to do is I'd like to ask Mike to come back up and after he's done speaking, if that's okay with you, Matt.
It's fine, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I have a question for you, Mike, and the question is simply, is the change order subject to the bid price, number one? That's number one. And
yes, it is.
It is, okay.
And these, I mean, could you, all the numbers are verified by Beta, our engineering firm.
Mm-hmm.
But if you'd like, I have no problem going back, and we can re-verify everything.
I'd like to make that motion to ask you to go back, verify it, and come back to us, please.
That's fine.
If that's okay, could I get a second?
And I'll second that.
Why don't we make a motion to withdraw until, if Mike does his work, he just puts it on when he's ready for it.
That would be the motion, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so a motion to withdraw by Ray.
That's fine.
And I second.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate that.
Second by Susan.
And thank you.
Did you get that, Ann? And that's the rationale for that is that Mike's going to check his numbers. When Mike's done that work, that way we don't put it on a specific date. But
yeah.
Thank you for bringing us those concerns.
Yeah,
Mr.
if it is subject to the bid prices and those are the numbers you're talking about, then I it's worth a look at. Thank you so much.
Right. Yeah, there you go.
Oh, dear.
All right, so all in favor of the withdrawal of that motion?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Item number 14 is a motion to reject the bids for preventive road maintenance for cape sealing, microsurfacing, crack sealing, and authorizing purchasing to solicit bids with modifications made to the bid specifications.
I'll move the motion.
Second.
Discussion? This is from Mike and Pam, correct? Do you want to explain?
Mike just simply told me that he needs more in this bid. He wants it to go back out again. Can you be more specific for the council, Mike, than you were?
It's some minor bid specification changes that we need to make for the micro paving.
Okay, I'm seeing the crack sealing polymer and the crumb rubber. Is that the part of the bid that you're going to be rebidding?
Yeah.
Okay, and I see a bid from one, two. I'm sorry. Excuse me for a moment. Three companies, is that correct?
Right. We're actually deleting the crack sealing portion from the project.
Oh, okay.
We're going to delete that portion.
I understand.
We actually already have a current MPA bid that's active until 2018 that the town already uses. So we're going to delete that part, and we got to make some adjustments to the micro paving portion of the bid.
That's clear. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Item 16 is a motion to appoint independent counsel to represent the town in the Superior Court case due to conflict with the solicitor. Is this still on?
Mr. President, that lawsuit has been withdrawn. That was a Superior Court tax appeal, and it has been withdrawn.
Okay, so item number 16 is withdrawn. Dawson had put it on, and Dawson's withdrawing it. Okay, so for the record, item 16 withdrawn. Thank you. Item 17 is a motion to schedule a performance review for the position of town solicitor and schedule a litigation update.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
I just put this on as we're reviewing all the time. We just finished the manager, so I thought it would be an appropriate time to look at the solicitor. Yep.
So there's two things going on. Also, we get an update on the litigation for the town at the same time. And we've been reviewing. We're in the process of reviewing. We've had our review with Pam Dawson. Hopefully, we'll be reviewing the municipal court judge. So we want to look at dates for this particular review, probably on an off night of what we want to see what council members and Dawson have for their calendars.
Are we rolling both of these into one night?
Oh,
the,
yeah.
The performance review update. And the litigation update?
Oh, yeah, that can be the
okay,
same night.
Okay, that's
yeah.
all I want to know.
I think the off night is important, though.
Yeah, no, we want to do it an off night.
Mr. President, my calendar is clear on the evening of the 25th, which is this coming Monday.
Is that 6:30?
Anytime that's convenient to the council.
Is that available for everybody else?
I'm not clear on that.
Yep.
Not clear. Chris, can we go into February on this?
Can we look at?
I'm going to have to go later because I know the 8th is not good for me. So what's the week after
22.
The 15th, Ann?
22nd.
February 22nd. I mean, we don't have to do it on a Monday, but if everyone's agreeable to the 22nd of February, does that work for you, Dawson?
Yeah, it does.
I can do it too.
Yep.
Everybody else?
Yep.
Yeah.
And what time do we want to do that?
6:30.
6:30. Okay, so 6:30 p.m., February 22nd. And that's a week after President's Day, correct, Ann? All right. All in favor of the motion for 6:30 p.m. review of Dawson on February 22nd. That will be an executive session, Dawson, correct? It's your discretion. Well, you can think about it.
Well, certainly the litigation portion has to be, but
yeah.
I have no problem with it, executive session.
Okay, great. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved 5-0. Item 18 is a motion to adopt a resolution in opposition to Governor Raimondo's proposed truck toll gantries to be placed throughout the state of Rhode Island.
Okay.
Let's move.
Motion.
You got to second it, Patrick.
I will second it.
All right, so this is from Patrick and Chris. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Matt. Okay, we put this out there. As you know, the governor has this proposal to fix road and bridges by placing truck toll gantries throughout the state. Chris and I put this together to get a resolution against this proposal for several reasons, and we're looking for town council approval. So I normally don't weigh in to state issues, especially one that's this is a controversial one, but this directly affects my constituency. Galilee is one of the major fishing ports in New England and the East Coast, and we have a lot of heavy-duty truck traffic, and I believe it will hurt my constituency, loss of jobs, higher grocery costs for goods and services. So this is why it's on here tonight, and I hope other towns follow suit to derail this plan, because I just don't want to give the state another mechanism to arbitrarily tax. You know, today it's going to be trucks. Tomorrow it's commercial vehicles. Within 5 years, you can't get a skateboard through there without some kind of tax or levy. So this is why it's on here tonight. Chris? Thank you.
Maybe I should just take a minute and read part of the motion so people will know exactly what we're talking about. I'll just read the whereas portions here. whereas the governor's proposal will add additional financial burdens to families by increasing the already high cost of goods and services in Rhode Island, and whereas the governor's proposal will add additional burdens to all Rhode Island businesses, resulting in more direct and indirect loss of jobs in Rhode Island, and whereas the governor's proposal will likely be viewed nationwide as yet another Rhode Island anti-business, anti-consumer tax, and whereas the governor's proposal ignores other alternative and substantially more fiscally sound pay-as-you-go proposals, and whereas the governor's proposal increases our state's already high bonded debt by at least another $1.3 billion, and whereas the governor's proposal is widely regarded as a gateway tax that will eventually lead to the tolling of all vehicles. Now that's roughly what I think about. I can't really add that much more onto it. It's my understanding ever since this was submitted to the clerk's office that we've had several other communities interested in. We are the first ones to approach this. We've had at least two other communities that I know of who are looking for a template to use to pass a similar proposal. So I'll just open it up. I know Ray was interested in it. I know there might be some people in the audience who might be interested in weighing in on this.
So I'm going to just weigh in a little bit. So I appreciate you putting this on the agenda. I actually think it is irresponsible and premature to actually pass a resolution since the General Assembly hasn't received it. And I'm not quite sure what the impact will be. So until it gets to the General Assembly, until I see the proposal, I mean, we just found out 2 weeks ago where the stops were going to be. So I think it's evolving. I think there are conversations still happening. So although I'm not sure if I agree or I'm opposed to it, I still think there's more to come on it. And I think it would be irresponsible if we just put out a resolution to stop without having the full vetting of what the proposal was in the General Assembly. So for those reasons, I'd like to hold off.
Well, I think to your point, I understand where you're coming from, but correct me if I'm wrong, I think the Senate already passed this last year, and they basically passed it without knowing any details. There was a mishmash of facts coming out or a lack of facts coming out, and they still passed the thing. I know, from what I understand, it is the administration's full intention of going forward with this. And I think if we wait any longer, I mean, even typos and some misspellings aside, if we wait any longer in moving on this, it might just be too late. Because these things tend to come down very quickly.
This is another one of these pieces of legislation that's going to happen in the middle of the night. And, you know, and we'll wake up and then all of a sudden,
I agree that perhaps it may be a tad premature, but when I look at what happened to the rental units in Narragansett, and suddenly they had an 8% tax on them, and that kind of hit me between the eyes. I didn't see that coming at all. So it may be a tad premature, but it's a stance that I think we have to make because we are one of the, I think we're the third largest fishing port in the East. And there is a choice. When somebody's fishing at Georgia's Bank, they can go to Massachusetts, they can go to Connecticut, they can go a lot of different places and steam there, pay less for their fuel to dump their catch, and why give them another reason to go up on to leave Narragansett, to leave Galilee? We've got enough issues here. We need to take a stance on this, and it may be a tad early, so you may be right, but I don't think it's going to hurt to put it out there. I'm going to agree that it's a good thing to give our voice to. Thank you for putting it out, Chris, and I appreciate it.
Thank you. The 14, I know there's a few hands I see up. We're going to get to you. The 14 gantries, do we have the list of those?
Yes. Is it? This young lady brought some.
Who's the young lady?
Pam.
All right. Pam. Do you want to come forward, please?
That's a lot of information.
All right. Welcome.
Thank you.
Glad to be here. I appreciate the opportunity to speak about the issue. Is this on? Can you hear me?
Should be.
I think so. There's a red light.
Yes.
Yep. Speak into it a little bit.
My name is Pam Giancarella, and I'm here on behalf of Stop Tolls RI. We are a coalition of citizens groups that have gathered to oppose the governor's toll plan and actually to oppose any plan that includes any new tolls on Rhode Island's highways. I do appreciate that you have brought forth this resolution. As you said, this is one of the first towns to do that. However, there are quite a number that have at least put the discussion on the table, on their agendas, and ultimately I believe there will be a number of new resolutions. You mentioned local reasons why this would not be a good proposal for Narragansett, which quite honestly I hadn't really thought of. One of our biggest concerns is the permanent nature of this legislation. This legislation, once this is passed, the state intends to spend $50 million to erect those gantries. Once those gantries go up, they're not coming down. I think it would be hard pressed to push the General Assembly in the future to reverse this legislation. So I think it is imperative to lend your voice if that's how you feel, because this will be permanent legislation. Why we oppose the tolls? Of course, for a number of reasons. The primary reason being we believe that it will be tolls on trucks today and on automobiles tomorrow. But in addition to that, just taking a look at the huge risk involved in this proposal. You see, I gave you a handout there with booklet, and it has, I think, a great visual. It's a small map of the state with, you know, these little red dots, these little balloons. That's only 14 of the initially proposed 17 to 20 gantries. If you show that to a business considering coming to this state, what do you think that says to that business? Is that welcome to Rhode Island? Is that we're open for business? I don't think so, and I'm not sure, but I don't think you do either. I think that provides a really good visual of how Rhode Island will be perceived with these gantries. The plan itself, when the governor introduced it last spring, she thought she had a great plan for Rhode Island. Part of the biggest piece of the plan, of course, is the projected toll revenue. That plan came out at $100 million of projected toll revenue. A couple of weeks later, she had to revise that down because she misspoke, I guess, about the classes of trucks that were going to be subject to the toll. When she went back to revise, she dropped that toll revenue projection by 40%. And at the same time, she extended the life of the bond to 30 years from, I think the original was 15. That increased the interest cost for Rhode Islanders about 70%. Just a couple of weeks ago, or maybe even last week, the Trucking Association had commissioned a study by IHS Global Insight. They looked at the toll projections, and they looked at one piece of that, which was the number of trucks expected to traverse the state's highways. The Trucking Association has long said, you know, I'm not sure about those truck numbers. They don't really look right. And sure enough, IHS came out with their study and said those truck numbers do not look right. I think at best they think it's 50% of what's in the proposal. They adjusted down the toll projections another 30%. So originally the plan came out here, great plan. Today we're looking at toll projection revenues coming down by 70%, interest costs increasing by 70%. And quite honestly, I don't know how anybody can sit there and say that that's a viable plan. Now, I don't know, obviously, as much about the details as the governor does because she hasn't released much of the information, but any plan that starts out good here, how can it still be a viable plan here? So we have an issue with that, and believe it, the toll projection, the revenue projections are the critical piece, the critical component of this plan. In addition to that, I hate to get in the weeds, but looking at the diversion rate about trucks, you know, this plan is focused on extracting money from interstate trucking. The diversion rate is a critical piece of that. The Trucking Association came out a couple of weeks ago with a survey that they took of their own members where they said 77% of trucks would always divert, meaning go around the state. An additional 22% would sometimes divert. That's very different from what the governor has used in her projections of 25% diversion. And that gap needs to be closed. That, you know, the right diversion rate or a better estimate needs to be on the table for that.
and used in the projections. This IHS study, which, by the way, is also in your package, the REMI model that the governor had used for looking to do an impact study, but Speaker Matty Ellis said, you know, we don't want to pass anything before we have an impact study. And that model came up with looked at what the impact would be on the economic growth of the state based on the toll proposal. And the IHS study looked at that, and the REMI model itself said the benefit we would benefit by less than 0.1% on economic growth in Rhode Island from the toll proposal. The IHS study said that is generous. So in looking at, you know, risk-reward ratios, I would have guessed that the 38 studios would have had a better risk-reward than right. this plan. And don't forget, 38 studios is $100 million. This is $1.2 billion, 10 times more. Another piece, another high-risk component is the issue about the interstate commerce law. The Rhode Island Truckers Association believes they have case law on their side that targeting a specific class of trucks is against the interstate commerce law. So how long will that be in litigation while, in the meantime, we're building the gantries? Of course, there's always the risk to the Rhode Island economy itself as a whole. The trucking industry testified in the House Finance Committee last June that their industry would be decimated. Now, this is, of course, at a time when we're trying to attract industry into our state. And they're telling the governor and the speaker and the Senate president this will decimate their industry. Matter of fact, I think the governor came out with the Brookings Institute plan today. I just heard it briefly on the radio, right. where they said the trucking industry is very important to Rhode Island. So why would we be aiming a gun at the trucking industry? Their testimony, in addition, when they talked about, you know, what would happen if this legislation was passed, I don't believe that was exaggerated, and I don't believe it was just rhetoric. And I think you can clearly see that UPS has pulled 10 tractor-trailer trucks, along with their jobs, out of the state of Rhode Island and moved them to Massachusetts. I think that's a very good indication that this is a reality for this trucking industry. Of course, there's also the, as you mentioned, increased cost to consumers. The trucking industry is not a charitable organization. They are not going to absorb that cost. Those costs will be passed down to the consumer on every good they buy. The next risk, of course, is the risk of pulling $600 million out of the Rhode Island economy and sending that off to Wall Street, because that's what they expect to do.
That's right.
The bond interest, I think, is around $580 million. I think that is something that we need to think about.
I'm going to, just because you've got a little bit over, I'm going to ask for the record the list of the 14 gantries, if we could add that to the minutes of this meeting, not the map, but the actual list, so that we have that as part of our record, because I think that's an important piece of the puzzle. So just, we don't need a motion or anything. Ann, you could just do that. Do you have this packet? Okay, you'll have it from her. Okay, yep. If you could provide that to Ann, like I said, it's the table, not the map.
Absolutely.
That way you'd know where it is. So,
I'll wrap it up.
Thank you.
The biggest piece is there is an alternative. The Republican Policy Group has put out an alternative to this plan, and that is simply prioritize spending. If infrastructure is crumbling, if it's a priority, that's where we spend our first dollars. In that package is a list of the items, the sources for funding through the budget that the Republican Policy Group has put together. In addition to that, I provided you with the report from the Rhode Island Center for Freedom and Prosperity. It's called Spotlight on Spending, where 2 years ago, prior to any toll proposal, they proposed $225 million of non-priority spending. Republican group is open to any suggestions. So, you know, there's another $225 million. In conclusion, because of the permanent nature of this legislation, because of the risks to our economy, because it is seen as hostile to business, and because it will be trucks today and cars tomorrow, and because, most importantly, there are alternatives out there, we ask that you pass this resolution opposing both the governor's toll plan as well as any future plans, including tolls on Rhode Island's highways. Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
you want me to, right. Do you have any questions?
Richard, yep, we might call you back if we have questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard.
By certainly focusing on Galilee gives this a good entree for this council. I mean, this industry is a crucial one. Just spent a lot of time studying the history of Galilee, rather fascinating story. But fishermen and provide a tremendous economic benefit for not only us in Narragansett, the state and the country. And I would hope that the Chamber of Commerce and any Galilee group would join us in this. I think it's very, very, very important that we as a council protect our constituents. We do have constituents here that are in business. And certainly, fishing is a off and on thing. It doesn't take very much on the off side to cause all sorts of grief. And if it's a question of port, what port do you enter in? Yes, it does mean something to us here in Narragansett. So where originally I was indifferent, I'm no longer indifferent because we do have a constituent here that deserves a voice. And I would hope the Narragansett Chamber of Commerce, and if there is a similar group in Galilee speaking for the fishermen, would also add to what this vote is, would be very helpful.
Thank you.
Well, to Richard's point,
Stan, and then Meg.
But just a comment.
It's all interstate.
Wait. Let Chris go, and then Susan.
And just a comment to Richard's point. I know Ray brought this up about the Galilee fishing industry actually paying these tolls. But you have to be very careful because what I'm hearing that the industry is working in and out of Quonset already have their waiver. If you start saying, well, we'll vote for this, we'll go with the gantries, we'll go with the tolls, but we want a waiver from, we want an exception to the law. Well, I understand this already happened to the Quonset industries. They're exempt from this. Then Narragansett says, well, it's okay with us. We want a waiver too. Then Providence says, well, we want a waiver until the Port of Providence, trucks going in and out. Then Newport says, well, we have a fishing industry too, and a big industry. We want a waiver over there. I look at this as, the lady before there, Pam, gave a very good testimony onto the negatives. I just don't see any positives to it, but it comes right down to the essence is there, can you tolerate gantries in Rhode Island? Do you think that's a good idea for any reason?
I'm still in my same position, premature and irresponsible.
Good evening. Happy New Year to all. I thank the sponsors and I encourage the council to approve this purposeful resolution and continue the work the people of Rhode Island have begun by saying no to the imposition of tolls. The toll plan could be, and no doubt will be, challenged in court, for it represents a possible high likelihood of a violation of the Dormant Commerce Clause of the United States Constitution. The reason being is that the governor's plan as presented last session had carve-outs for Quonset and Green Airport, and you're not supposed to treat people differently. Further, we know that we cannot trust what the governor or the General Assembly tell us about that the tolls will only be imposed on the trucks, and we have the proof. We can't trust them because we pay gas taxes and auto fees, which have bypassed their original purpose, which was for road and bridge maintenance. That's found its way into the general fund. The 9/11 telephone surcharge Rhode Islanders pay is no longer used just for 9/11 services, as we've learned through multiple investigations. The lottery proceeds are not being used just for education. There are so many violations of public trust on the part of those who collect our tax dollars and spend them. Frankly, they lied about the purpose and they applied it when they couldn't do their jobs and balance the budget. The most egregious violation of the public trust is when the taxpayer got stuck with the bill to pay the moral obligation bonds on 38 studios due to the influence peddling in insider deals in the General Assembly in collusion with the former governor's EDC. Not good. Can you imagine gantries being placed at the gateways of South County as people try to access our beaches? This plan was soundly rejected in Massachusetts when the proposal was brought forth to put tolls on the Bourne and Sagamore bridges. That was shut down in a New York second. Tolling cars, which will inevitably happen, could greatly adverse tourism in Narragansett and throughout South County in our state. This has been pointed out by the prior speaker. This council can say no tonight to cluttering the Rhode Island roadways with the capacity of creating mega ATM machines that can literally tax anything that moves in front of it. We know this will not be limited to trucks. We must push our leaders to prioritize the spending of our tax dollars, or they will continue to do further harm to our economy. We have an $8.67 million budget for a state with a declining population of 1 million people. And to Susan's point, you bet it's evolving. That's precisely why acting now is so vital and so critical. The governor has stated publicly on numerous occasions that she wants swift passage, which you can guarantee will account for very little opportunity for oversight or for our town councils and chambers of commerce to weigh in. Councilor Rinaldi pointed out that this recently happened last June with the 8% taxes on summer cottages, which again is yet another burden on the people that live in Narragansett. So I applaud the sponsors and I urge passage tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Stan.
I wasn't planning on speaking on this, but boy, it's a disaster. We should act sooner. We're too late already, maybe. Thank God at least you got off your duff and get onto this right away. This is another tax. They didn't want to call it a tax, but it's money out of our pockets. Right. They're trying to getting money out of our pockets. Instead of calling it a tax, we're gonna tax the truck drivers. Initially, I said, oh, if I was a truck driver, who cares? But now I see the problem. Now it's gonna cost me money for the products I have to buy. This is a disaster. We have to really, I wish we had stronger language in there somehow to really get them upset or get their interest here. And then you look at the bond interest. I realize almost $600 million for interest, bonds, finance guys, bonds, taxes, bonds, state. This is so bad. I'm sitting here, I'm just so upset. And I'm so happy, at least, that you've responded quickly. Get it out right away. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. All right.
I just want to say one more thing. When I was a kid, when they came out with the lottery, I was supposed to pay for college. I don't know how many semesters they paid for, but I never heard anything more about that. Newport Bridge, once it was built, once we got the tolls, there are going to be no more tolls. So you can't accept the word of our General Assembly because time and time again, they've gone back on that. So I think this is a very dangerous system to put in place. And as Pam related, for those permanent taxes that will be imposed. And the thing about taxes, they all run downhill. You're going to see it in higher grocery costs, higher fuel costs. And it isn't the fleet of fishing boats. It's going to be the deckhand on the fishing boat. It's going to be the truck driver. There's going to be one less truck driver. This is bad on all levels. So I appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right. Yeah, so I just wanted to, when I look at the resolution, a lot of people know that I don't always like to weigh in on state issues, but a couple years ago I was kind of forced to on a big one, and on some level it feels very reminiscent of that. I mean, we look at the 38 studios issue and what happened there in the General Assembly, and its tendency to go for gimmicks to fix problems, and then, you know, we oppose the old council opposed the Deepwater project going through and wrecking our pier and our beach, and I got the scars to prove my fight against that one. So, and this kind of rings similarly, this toll proposal. So I think if we're going to protect the people of the state from increased fees, increased taxes, I think it's a good resolution to support. So all in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed?
Nay.
Motion approved, 4-1. Item number 8, thank you. Item number 19, a motion to appoint individuals to the Capital Reserve Committee.
I move the motion.
Second.
Discussion?
We already have a Capital Reserve Committee. The only difference, as I read through it, and correct me if I'm wrong, Ray, is we have to appoint a citizen, Chris, tonight. But all the other portions of the resolution we adopted in 2009, we brought it back, we made an amendment, so I just was wondering if anybody saw anything different.
I don't think that that the town finance director, no, the school finance director were appointed, and I just thought that they had to be appointed.
Yeah, so what...
So those two people, I feel, should be voting members, and I think that that's an important thing to have. And then I also, I don't know if you got the Chris Catanzaro, so I'd like to, at the same time, nominate him to be appointed.
So, Ray, you had made some tweaks to this, and we did the resolution that they went from 2009 at the last meet.
Yes, sir.
At the last meeting. And, in the end,
Did you want to review those or no?
No, I actually had Ann print it for us with your stuff. So the resolution itself includes the appointment of the town manager, the town finance director, school finance director. So by resolution, they're on. The resolution does it. So
Thank
we don't
you.
Need
I,
to
I
appoint
didn't
them.
See that.
Yeah. Well,
I
did
imagine.
It 2 weeks ago. This was you. This was your resolution.
What I did.
Yeah.
Oh, you.
So we.
Right,
they're
thank
on.
You.
So
well,
the motion
it.
Itself. Right,
I appreciate that.
Yeah,
thank
no,
you.
So the thing
I,
is.
I guess I did.
I just.
Than
yeah.
I
no. I think just so you just technically the resolution put them on. They're on the committee. And the date that they were put on would be the date the resolution signed. The only thing was one of the gaps from the prior year was that at-large person was never appointed. Last year, when that committee didn't meet, and the other, just so people know for the record, the other members are two current members of the town council. They've already been appointed. It's Susan and Patrick. And then, as I said, the finance directors of both the school and the town, and the school superintendent, town manager, and member of the school buildings committee, two current members of the school committee. But then we've got to put that at large person. So really, that's all we're doing is Chris Catanzaro.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm sorry for the confusion.
Just so everybody, all right, so then it would just be a motion to appoint Chris Catanzaro as the at-large member of the Capital Reserve Committee.
I'll move the motion.
I think I already did.
Was there a
that's
second?
Okay. I'll second if that's
yeah. Well,
the
it's
case.
It's more specific because it's appointed. To, we're just appointing one. So
that's not a problem. I don't have a problem with that. Thank
discussion.
You.
Yes.
I'm so happy that we got this on there to pay attention to money again. That's something that sometimes I think is lost sometime. The citizen now, I'm hoping that he's a finance type guy. Finance type guy, right? Because that's what I just want to get the most knowledgeable financial minds on this thing so we have analysis. Now, are these going to be open meetings so citizens can listen to what they have
sir.
To see? What they're
saying? Yes, Stanley, just so the Capital Reserve Committee, and when Ray brought it up, the concern was they really had not, they'd kind of that year not really done their
that's
meetings.
Right,
that's what happened. And so there hadn't been the at-large member appointed. and then the two finance directors weren't on the committee. So that those are some of the things that Ray changed. And then that Capital Reserve Committee will feed in and give recommendations on the budget for when we do the whole budget workshop.
How come the thing fell apart? How come it even fell apart?
It just didn't meet. Sometimes that happens with committees, you know? So it just, it's nobody's, nobody's fault, right?
Stanley, it's part of the...
Thank God it come back. You know, thank God it come back. Thank you very much.
We only meet once a year, and there was difficulty with the manager. I don't think I made that meeting. I'm not sure if you made one. There's only one.
Nobody ever told me about it.
It's only one.
You actually showed up.
Once a year, they missed it?
Actually, that doesn't sound, enough.
Stanley,
are you talking, how many millions of dollars are we talking, and we're only going to meet once a year? That doesn't sound right.
Okay.
At least a quarterly meeting.
Well, they can meet more often, Stan. But remember, Stan, Stan, listen, those still get fed into the budget process. In the end, the council is going to approve the budget. So they make recommendations, but in the end, at our budget workshops, which we have in April, that still gets fed in. So it's another... It's a feeder into that, but remember, because the school is independently elected on the school side,
committee?
You have to have this hybrid. We have to have this hybrid committee.
We have committee.
Last committee year, we didn't hear much from them.
Should meet more than once to discuss millions of dollars.
Stanley, there's a school committee, too, that is charged with the school's budget,
but this
too.
Seems
this
to be
is
at
just
least
a combination.
Kind of an ad hoc on the outside of the system. I'm hoping this is like on the outside of the system that looks at this thing from a financial perspective more than once.
Stanley, we're cranking this meeting up again, okay? We're cranking it up.
Stanley, you make it stand.
Yeah, I understand that, but, you know, this is a capital reserve. How many millions of dollars are we
But, Stanley, don't forget we did do the maintenance of effort, $400,000 back, so we did a good job on taking some money back to taxpayer last year.
I'm hoping we're going to do a better job with this thing now and really get this thing down, but I don't think one meeting's enough. I think there's going to be numerous meetings by this committee. But, sounds like it's a professional type committee, and I want them to have more time to discuss this thing.
So
we'll tell them.
We'll let them know that recommendation.
So, Stanley, if I may address...
Go ahead. Yes.
If I may address it. Number one, the original proposal did not have targets for them. One of the targets is a 3% amount of money that they can work on to protect the assets. That $21.5 million bond years ago?
Yes.
We want to protect those assets to make them not fall through the cracks again. Okay, that's number one. And then number two, we spoke, Kathy Cipolla and the... Laura Kenyon the business manager at the school, spoke about what is the least that they could reasonably have, and 2% as a savings account, if you will, just for emergencies, was the number. So there's an enormous amount of preparation that has to be done by the school department and by our finance director, to give the people who are going to be in this meeting, a very important meeting, to give them the information. So are they going to have to do a lot of work? Not really, not the people in this meeting, but the people who prepare for this meeting are going to have to be quite pointed, and they're going to have their ducks in a row, so that the MOE can almost automatically be taken care of with this, the maintenance of effort, and that fund balance be left where you're looking, as low as possible. So we're looking into it, and we've got some good people on our staff that can do it with this. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. You just put Chris Catanzaro as the at-large member of the committee. All right, so...
This was just a motion for a name, by the way.
Number 20 is a motion to appoint individuals to the Conservation Commission Tree Board to fill a vacant seat with a term expiring on April 30th, 2017.
Second.
And is there a specific person? There's two... dates, right? So there's two terms that are up here. One will be April of 2017. The other goes till 2018. So someone want to appoint
somebody? I saw
somebody.
Two great resumes.
The names,
I believe.
I have two names before me, okay, Mr. Brian Wagner and Stephanie.
Wait. So
more?
The first, one at a time, guys, okay? First, the first one is going to get a term till 2017. Who do you want to appoint to that term? I'm going to put a name forward. The other person would have it till April of 2018.
I move Stephanie
for the 2017?
Sure.
All right. Is there a second?
Second.
Ray. All right. All in favor of Stephanie Figari to be appointed till April 30th, 2017?
Aye.
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 All opposed. Motion approved, 5-0. And now, is there a motion to appoint somebody on the board till April 30th, 2018?
Brian Wagner.
Second.
Motion to appoint Brian Wagner until 2018. Ann, do you have that? Help you out? All right. Good. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Okay.
Good.
Thank you, everyone. Item number 21. A motion to appoint an individual to the Harbor Management Commission to fill a vacant seat as an alternate member with a term expiring on June 30th, 2016.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. I actually have a question, Ann. Is Mr. Morocco leaving the alternate spot?
So Jerry Totaro is the name up for this spot?
And this Dr. Totaro would then be an alternate, only serving for 4 months, it looks like. Right.
Well, it depends on what we want to do, really.
Yep.
No, June 30th, 2016.
Oh, we can't change that?
Oh, no, okay. Ray, so it looks like, that was my question. I didn't know that Ray had stepped down. So that's what's going on, Ann? Okay, so what we're doing is, if somebody wants to...
I will put Jerry Totaro.
Totaro on till, to that. Close out that term.
Sure.
Yeah,
and I'll second that.
Put that on to close the term.
Great. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion approved, 5-0. And finally, a motion to reappoint one individual to the Towers Committee for a 2-year term to expire on August 1st, 2017. We'll take the reappointment by itself. Is there a motion to reappoint John Miller?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Okay, motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. And appoint David. One individual as a resident at large to fill an unexpired term expiring on August 1st, 2016.
Is that David Quinn?
How many positions are open?
The problem at Towers right now, just so everybody knows, Mr. Dave O'Brien left town and served for a long time on that committee and was an excellent member to that committee. So we wish him. Thank him for his service. We then also, I believe Mary Beth Arnold left the committee. She resigned, and she served as the secretary while I had been on it, so I also want to thank her for her service. We also lost Mr. Wright because he died, so, and we all know about his contributions to the town. And then who else am I missing, Ann?
That's it.
Okay.
So
then now we've got to fill some of those positions.
Okay.
So the reappointment was Mr. Miller.
Wouldn't it be appropriate to appoint David Quinn to Mr. Wright's position?
Yes.
Just because?
Yeah, if he can fill, that's the term that expires 2016.
Right. So I'd like to nominate David Quinn for that spot.
Second.
Okay, so we got that in?
Yep.
All right. Yep. Discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion approved, 5-0. And then is there a motion to appoint a resident at large for a 2-year term to expire on October 1st, 2017?
Well, I heard from Jim Durkin, and he's willing to do this, so I would make a motion to appoint Jimmy.
Is he on this list?
He's not on the list, though, Jimmy.
I don't think
he didn't he send an application?
I thought it was Donald Chernick.
Chernick. He didn't, we don't.
Oh, he did.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Then I stand corrected.
All right, so I'll put Donald Chernick up.
Okay, is the motion for Donald Chernick. All right, is there a second for that?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0.
So can I just
ask, is there an additional vacancy?
Yeah, so I just wanted to ask a question about Mr. Durkin that you said just called. So is there one open spot that nobody's applied for? So, although the name, Jimmy Durkin's name isn't on this, we could give him one of those spots at this time, since we just filled the Donald Chernick.
I'd like to make that motion, if I could.
All right, and then I would second that.
Second. All right. In discussion on that, is there, I see you, Meg, just wait 1 second. And what would be the time that term would expire?
So it's David, Donald Chernick, and Jimmy.
That would go till 2017? So he'd be taking Arnold's?
Correct. Okay, so that's 3, okay.
Okay.
That's fine.
All right, great.
We have to vote on it.
All right. Did you want to speak?
I'm not going to turn it into a hotel, is he?
Watch it, Patrick. just kidding. I'm delighted that you acted on this tonight because we've had a little bit of difficulty getting quorums with all the wonderful people we've lost in the committee. Everybody in the towers was well apprised of the fact that the two prior appointments you made tonight had their names in. And I know the committee has no knowledge of the other applicant's name, so I'm just asking if that's something that could wait a couple of weeks until maybe the Towers Committee has an opportunity to give this a little forethought. I don't know if it matters what the committee's response is, but, you know, it's just something to ponder.
So I did think about that. I hesitated, but I guess it's not the committee that really appoints that person. I think it's the council.
I understand. Yeah, so. I just thought maybe out of deference to the people that had served there a very long time.
I think they'll be satisfied, Meg, with the three people that we put on tonight.
I mean, it's...
Jimmy, we have an application. Are you interested?
Yeah, I submitted it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. So many people that
were interested. Yeah. Great. And he came last. We filled in the applicants that we had, so I think that's good.
All right.
Cool. So we had Jimmy's name
up.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion approved, 5-0. Item number...
Oop. That's it. You're done.
That's it. We're finished.
Too short?
Miracle.
Too short.
Well, we have some other work to do.
A motion to retire. One thing, I know that we're scheduling, we've got some things on OPEB and actuarial studies, but we'll talk about that another time. Yeah. Because we talked about maybe work sessions on that. When some of that information, just for the public, we're getting OPEB and actuarial information to set us up for the budget, so we probably would want to have that updated to us from the town manager and the finance director in more detail, but we'll have to schedule that at some point. All right, executive session, a motion to retire to executive session of the town council at the end of the January 19th, 2016 town council meeting in accordance with Rhode Island General Laws 42-46-4 to discuss collective bargaining Local 1589, International Association of Firefighters, AFL-CIO-CLC, and collective bargaining Local 303, International Brotherhood of Police Officers, as in accordance with 42-46-5, subsection A2, and potential litigation, National Grid versus Town of Narragansett, as in accordance with 42-46-5, subsection A2, and to appoint Dawson T. Hodgson, Town Solicitor, as Clerk Pro Tem.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Wilkins?
Aye.
Mr. Murray?
Aye.
Mr. Mannix? Aye. Ms. Bonanno?
Aye.
Mr. Rinaldi?
Aye.
Thank you, everyone. Good night, everybody.